So my story was that I graduated from seminary wanting to do some kind of full-time Christian ministry. I moved to Georgia, where I was assigned to be the youth pastor / assistant pastor. And it's such a small church, they said, why don't you get a part-time job? They were advertising on the radio for math teachers. I went in. A friend actually dragged me in because he knew the superintendent in February. And they said, he said, you need to be a teacher. I says, I don't want to be a teacher. I never even dreamed of being a teacher. He dragged me in. He says, you'll be a good teacher. So I became a substitute teacher, which is even worse, right? In a high school. And fortunately, I'm big. That helps a lot when you're a sub. I'm just telling you. And anyway, I substitute taught for 2 weeks. And then the next thing I know, I got a phone call. And they said, our math teacher is moving to a different position in the district. We would like you to be a math teacher starting tomorrow morning, March the 10th. No education classes, no math degree. Still not certified. I'm trying to encourage you, okay? Because I ended up getting teacher of the year, star teacher. I only taught for a couple of years there. But I found I had a gift for it. And the two classes I haven't had to be officially certified are curriculum and development, which I wrote. And the second one is methods of teaching math. It's a hands-on math class. I taught it one summer at a college, but I haven't had it yet. Are you getting a little bit more encouraged? There's no secret sauce that they teach teachers. So how many of you are first-time homeschoolers? Cool. You mean, how many of you are starting this coming fall? How many of you are finishing up your first year? Good. So you're rooks. Sorry, that's short for rookies. Congratulations. I'm one of the veterans. You know, we do rookie hazing and stuff. No, I'm just kidding. So I just want to help you because one of the biggest lessons I learned is, though, that I'm not a classroom teacher when I'm teaching my own children. I'm a tutor. And tutors do not follow classroom textbooks. What tutors do is they follow the students. So if I'm teaching a child, first thing I have to do is find out what they know. So those of you that are teaching your kid first time, don't assume anything. I mean, they may have been sick the week that they did decimals or something, and people have holes, and you got to fill up those holes because math is sequential. So the first thing you want to do is assess your student, and then you want to find out how they learn. You're going to start figuring that out really fast. Some kids want to act it out. Some kids want to build it. Some kids want to just hear it. Anyway, you'll figure that out. And then you want to move at the child's pace. So that's free. That wasn't in the notes. So anyway, so then I'm a school teacher, and then my fourth son was born with Down syndrome. And my wife and I burned out. He had lots of surgeries. I had to make a living. We moved to a different state. I started tutoring children, which that's what grew into Matthew C. So now you know the story. But when I was a school teacher, I always tried to make learning fun and understandable. I wanted kids to not just memorize stuff. I wanted them to learn what they were learning and stuff. So I remember teaching circumference. Who knows the formula for circumference? Go ahead, tell me, what is it? 2 pi r. Anybody got a different formula? Pi times the diameter. Right. The same thing. 2 r pi. Yeah, very good. See, we learn stuff. Okay, so the thing is, how do you tell children that the circumference of that circle you're looking at is really about 3 times as big as the diameter? So I would say to them, how long do you think my belt is? Circumference, right? It's going around my belly. And they would guess. And then I would take it off and they would go, wow. And then I would lay it on the floor. And they also thought that was pretty cool too. I would write with chalk on the carpet. And we would mark it out and then we would mark how long it was. And I said, how wide do you think I am? And now, how about that? It's about 3 times, right? They go, yeah. I said, that's called pi. But you see, I was trying to make it fun. I was making it interesting. And I was always using money. You know why? Money is the only thing in the decimal system that's based on 10. That clock, what's it go to before it turns around? 12. Months in a year. Inches in a foot. Eggs in a dozen. Tribes in Israel. Apostles. Okay, you get it? We are more base 12 than we are base 10. Money is your go-to all the time. And anytime I would go like this, everybody woke up in class. Because they knew I was going to offer a dollar for something or whatever. And I'm just telling you, this is the kind of stuff that I did to help make math fun. But back to your paper. 2012, God helped me to let go of the company. My sons are running it now. I have to do something to stay out of their way and make trouble. So I started building faith families. So I have a newsletter. I have a podcast. I wrote a bunch of books. If you would like to receive the newsletter, you can do it in a techie way. On the front of your handout, first line, you can text the number, put in faith and family with spaces, and you'll get it. If you're old school and have no idea what I'm talking about, I have old-fashioned sign-up sheets. Can you just circulate that? Just move it around. There you go. Thank you. And at the very bottom of the sheet, I wrote a personal finance program called Stewardship. Who's ever heard of it? I can explain it more in detail, but I wrote it for 15 to 18, 19-year-old kids who were thinking about their first car, getting a job. Why is my paycheck so much less than I thought it was going to be? What, you know, how to do percentages, all that. So this, I'm going to give one out. Okay? If you want to explore it, just look at stewardshipmath.com. The videos are free on this program. You stream them. This is 2-credit course. It's Bible and personal finance. I'm not going to go into detail. Who's got some 15 to 17-year-olds that would be interested in this program for next fall? Let me see your hands. Only one person? Two people. Okay, you got to make your case because we're going to vote. Okay, how many teenagers do you have? Two. How old are they? 13 and 15. How about you? A 17-year-old? Okay. Does a 17-year-old know how to spend money? Did he spend it too much? Oh, I see. Yes. What do you think? Okay. She deferred to you. Here you go. Salt and light. Merry Christmas. If the rest of you, I have one more set at the booth. I can show it to you in more detail if you want, but it's really good. Every worksheet has 7 questions about personal finance, 2 questions about Bible stuff that applies to it, and 1 question, I call it the parent dinner conversation. Like, where do your parents buy their used cars? Or do they buy new cars? Do your parents buy warranties? What do your parents think about where you should bank? Why do they bank there? There's a question every day for them to ask you because I want to facilitate discussion between the parents and the kids. All right, you all set? Okay, let's pray. Thank you, Father, for this workshop. Thank you for all the workshops that are going on. And we're painfully aware there's at least 2 other ones going on. But I pray that you help us to have ears to hear, get some good ideas so we can make math more fun for our kids. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to go through this list on your handout. Is that okay? And if there's something that I'm not touching, but this is just stuff that I do to try to make math interesting and fun to kids. I don't know if you know this, but the most important thing you can teach children in the decimal system is place value. I could tell you stories all day of people I've met that never understood place value, kept them out of colleges. I'm serious. They just never got it. So what I do is, I'm thinking about teaching this to elementary kids. This is a cul-de-sac. This is Decimal Street. It's got a little house at the end of the street. where the units live. It's got a taller house. That's where the tens live. It's got a castle over here. Lousy looking castle. And this is where the hundreds live. Okay. I don't know if you know this, but I'm just tell you how I teach it to like a 7-6-year-old kid. I would say, usually I would make that a green house, by the way, because there are green people that live in it. But I would say, how many beds in this house? Well, sorry, it's a bad illustration. Okay. It turns out there's 9 beds in this house. What color are they? Green. How many toothbrushes? 9. What color are they? Green. How many puppies? I don't know if you know this. Kids just eat this up. They just go, there's 9. What color are they? Green. And then I say, what else do you think's in the house? And the kids start saying, dishes, forks. What color are they? Green. Anyway, you just go back and forth. The main objective is have some fun, make a story. Children love stories, okay? So I tell them, yes, 9. But that's a huge concept because I don't know if you know it, in the decimal system, you don't count to 10. You count from 0 to 9, 10 to 19, 20 to 29. Okay? So there's only 9 people in this house. How many people are home today? 2. 1, 2. Okay? The 10's house, same thing. 10 long blue beds. High ceilings. You know, have fun with this. How many rooms in the 10's house? 9. How many are 10's are home today? 3. Okay, same thing with the hundreds. That's where the rich people live. It's the house at the end of the street. It's the castle. 9 possible, only 1 home today. I'm going to ask you a tricky question. When I got to teach my granddaughters during COVID, I taught them this first day. I taught them place value, and then I taught them, well, here's a tricky question. What's larger, 1 or 3? I can't hear anything you're saying. I see your lips moving, but I'm sorry. I'm just like, okay. But in this case, 100 is bigger than 3 tens. So what you should have said was, and maybe some of you were, and I couldn't hear you. You should have said 1 or 3 what? If I was to call my granddaughters right now on the phone and have it on speaker, I'd say, hey, it's larger, 1 or 3. And they'd say, 1 or 3 what, Papa? Because I taught them that, because these digits only tell you how many. Place value tells you what kind. Really big concept. Okay. Now, if you want to reinforce place value, as I already told you, pennies, dimes, dollars. Huge. Use money to reinforce place value. Next point. In the decimal system, which means based on 10, everybody wants to be 10. So I was trying to figure out how to teach some of these things to kids, and I started asking questions. And I said to this one girl in a workshop, I said, how old are you? She said, I'm almost 12. I said, cool, when's your birthday? She said, last week. She just turned 11, like a week before, and she says she's almost 12. And I realized that kids want to be more than what they are. You ever run across that? Okay, so with that in mind, I wanted to teach the kids how to add +9. So here's 10. Mr. 9, green with envy. Sorry. Mr. 9 wants to be 10. How much does he need to be 10? 1. So if I have 9, I should do this with my granddaughter. So if I have like 9 plus 4. And we'd have the blocks on the table, like the ones you have. And I'd say, 9 plus 4. And while I was doing that, they would go like this. They would sneak over and grab one and put it on the 10 because they were, okay. And I would look at it and say, and they would laugh and giggle and stuff. And I'd say, why did he do that? They said, because Mr. 9 wants to be 10. And he was always sneaking over and grabbing one. But now, we just discovered that 9 plus 4 is 10 plus 3, right? But then I thought, how can they remember that without going through this every time? Well, this is a vacuum nozzle. Did you know that? What does a vacuum cleaner sound like? Very good. I can see your lips. I don't hear anything, but I can see your lips. You're going like that. Okay. So I would go. So 9 was always trying to vacuum one. And it turns out that's really good math, because making 10 in the decimal system is pivotal. So you try 1. What's 9 plus 7? So you got 10 plus 6. It's good math. And then, who knows what block this is? Well, he's a little bit less than 9. He also covets. He's not content, because he wants to be 10 as well. But so here we have 8 plus 5. I don't know if you noticed this, but this is 2 vacuum nozzles. So what's that sound like? It's that's just one really big one. That might be like this one. Anyway, so it's so the kids get their little 8 bar out, and I'm just telling you, I've observed this. What parents will do is they'll put both of them here. But what kids do is they go like that. There's a vacuum nozzle on both sides, right? So the and that makes more sense. So now that's 10 plus 3, so it's 13. So this is just a way of teaching. I don't know if you know this, but there's like 55 addition facts. If you learn the ones and the twos, the zeros, easy. Doubles, easy. But this takes care of the nines and the eights, which are often very difficult for kids. But just tell them they really want to be 10. Now, I didn't even know this, but this is, you're adults now. Forget you're not a kid anymore. Ready? Okay. I want you to do this without this. Okay. No carrying. I just want you to think. What does 98 want to be? What does he need to be 100? So what's he going to make the noise? He's going to suck 2 from this one. Then what we got up here? 275 plus 100, 375. Isn't that amazing? I still want to wonder, why didn't they teach us that? This is not rocket science. Just making 10, making 100, that's how the decimal system is based. But if you make a game out of it, it's just a lot better. Okay? Okay. I learned this next math game from a teacher at a Christian school, and what she did was every day she would start by looking at the calendar and finding out what day of the week it was. So what day is today? 13? I don't even know. I can't see it. 13? Okay. How many ways can you show 13? And she would have the students start the class every day. Well, that would be 10 plus 3, 15 minus 2, 5 times 2 plus 3, whatever. But it was just a really interesting way to review all of their math skills. And maybe you have, I forgot to bring my raisins. I even went to Aldi's this week and bought boxes of raisins. I was going to throw them around the room when you got the answer right. But anyway, grandkids will have raisins. So, but this is what you want to do, is you just want to give prizes to kids. Say, if you can find 10 ways to show me 13, 26 divided by 2, you know, 39 divided by 3, you just keep going. But then the kids, they develop their number sense, and they're much more aware, and homeschoolers don't even know what month it is anyway, so it's really helpful to be able to read a calendar. I don't know about you, but when I was in school, I knew what day of the week, you know. Awful Mondays, Fridays, you know. And homeschool kids, they have days? Anyway, so, okay. Something else I used to find helpful. I measured my span. I do this a lot to this day. If somebody want, my span is 9 inches, which is small for big guys, by the way. So if I need to measure something, if I need to measure this table, that's 18, I'm going to say 24. That's a 2x4. That's 24x48, but I used my span, and it's just really helpful. And my grandfather taught me a long time ago, inch, my knuckle. My knuckle used to be an inch, now it's about a foot. Now it's bigger, so. But you got to measure your kids' stuff and have them say, how long is that? I just thought of something else my grandfather taught me. How many days in May? Knuckles, exactly. So you start at the end, the humps. Did anybody drive from Route 30 down here today? Did you see the sign, speed humps? I used to think that was speed bumps, wasn't it? I was laughing to myself, going, what is a speed hump? Anyway, so you got humps on your fingers. And so you got January, February, March, April, May, 31 days. June, 30. July and August both have 31. September, October, November, December. Who never saw that before? Cool. Okay, so, but that was, I used to knock that out of the park when I was in school because my grandfather taught me this cool trick, and they, 30 days, that's September, April, just look at you. Got it. Okay, fun things. Okay, get your blocks out. Some of you already have them out. Okay. Can you make a rectangle with 6? You can use, if you want to, you could use a 2. You could use 2 3s, whatever you want. Make a rectangle with 6. Okay. So, what are the factors of this rectangle I got up here? What are the edges? How far across the bottom, everybody? 2. How far up the side? 3. So the factors are 2 by 3. I don't know if you know this, but most multiplication problems, you're given the factors, factor, and you multiply and find the product. I just went in reverse. I gave you 6. You built a rectangle, and you said, oh, that's 2 times 3. Okay, can you make another rectangle, still with 6, but don't just turn it sideways. That's the same rectangle. Okay, that doesn't count. One time he's standing, one time he's lying down. Can you make another rectangle using 6? Let me see them. How many of you did this one? Okay. 1 by 6. So we just found the factors by building a rectangle. Okay, get 12. Tell me how many rectangles you can make out of 12. Okay, how many rectangles did you get? You got 3. Okay, what was your rectangle dimensions? 2 by 6? 3 by 4? And 1 by 12? Everybody agree with that? Okay, nice job. Here's a raisin. Fake raisin. Okay. Now, get out 7, please. you can get 2 threes and a one, 2 twos and a three. I don't know how many blocks you have, a five, whatever. Get seven. Okay, now watch. Okay. Uh-oh, all I have is a 20. So the first person that can make two different rectangles out of seven, $20. No, don't just do that flippy thing to me. I want two different rectangles. You got to use seven in each rectangle. It says Matthew C, not Matthew Saw. So you can. Okay, you already figured it out, right? How many rectangles can you make out of seven? One. What do you call a number that you can only make one rectangle? Prime. I don't know if you know, but there's a big name for the 6 and the 12. Those are called composite numbers. Composite numbers, you can make at least two rectangles. But prime number, one rectangle. I just think that's so much, it's so superior to a number that can only be divided by one in itself, or a number that only has for factors one in itself. Every time I would hear the definition of a prime number, I'm going, now I just say, it makes one rectangle. Kids go, got it. So, all right? But I don't know if you know, prime numbers are big stuff in advanced math. Rectangles. A rectangle comes from German. It means right angle, square corners. Somebody tell me three rectangles they see in this room. Okay, board. The what? Signs. Oh, those things are rectangles. That thing's a rectangle. This is really fun stuff to do because rectangles are all around us. But you can do that with any of the shapes. Does anybody see a triangle in the room? Big triangle. Probably the same sides. Isosceles. Okay. So finding shapes in real life is pretty cool. Another thing. When I was teaching, well, you can see it in your notes, but a lot of students used to get confused between perimeter and area. So I would do like this. Okay? Because the perimeter is the rim. It's the edge. And I would try to explain to him. I said, when I used to do finished carpentry, you have to figure out the perimeter of the room for your baseboards. The perimeter of each door for your finished trim. Crown molding, perimeter, right? But if you're figuring how much paint to use to paint that room or how much flooring to cover the room, you have to know how to do. Squarea. Because square area. Because it's how many square feet. How many square feet. It's squares. Whereas perimeter is just the rim around the edges. Okay? Whenever I introduced hard words, hangman. Who knows how to play hangman? All right. Who wants to go first? By the way, all you get is head, body, two legs, two feet, two arms. I mean, two hands. That's it. And then that guy's toast. Yes, sir. Go ahead. A. By the way, this is a famous mathematician. E. That's his head. Yes. M. This is his body. See. A what? C T. S? Show it to me. What are you saying? S. S? You guys are really close. Okay, this guy's name is pronounced Descartes. Actually, it's Descartes. Okay, but it's interesting because Descartes developed the Cartesian coordinate system. Remember the okay. And I forgot this game. It just came to me, so that's why I chose his name. You remember this? You got the X and the Y axis. And this is 1, 2, 3, 4, -1, -2. Who remembers that? When I was teaching this to kids, I thought, how can I make this fun? So I went down to the library and I found they had this big grid board and we played Battleship. I divided the class in half and I put the board in the middle of the room and we used to put you put a sub over here, you know, your destroyer down here, whatever. And the other team got 100 for the day if they won. And they would say, -2, 3. Hit. Then the other team went, you know, back and forth. But it was really a fun way to learn the Cartesian coordinate. Because when you're playing a game like this, everybody in the whole class is focused on the negatives and the positives and things like that. Okay. When? Sometimes I would get inspiration when I was teaching. I don't know if you heard, but there was an animal that escaped from the York fairgrounds. So you guys got to be careful because he could be right around here somewhere. And this animal is called a zoid. So what you have to do, though, you have to create its native environment to trap him. So he lives in a mountain. And he's got an escape tunnel and an entrance tunnel. But his tunnel is perfectly parallel lines. And so this little zoid walked up here and he went in and we closed the doors. And that's how you trap a zoid. Come on, that was pretty good, don't you think? Okay. That was inspiration one day. And I was teaching this and I thought, how can I make this fun for the kids? But you'd be surprised. Who's already seen that before? I'm at conferences and people come up, do you still do the trapezoid? They remember it because it's a story and it's fun. Okay? I can do it. Okay. The most important thing to teach in geometry is the Pythagorean theorem. And here's how we're going to do it with blocks. This is a right triangle, and I want you to notice that the triangle is on the inside here, okay, and these are the sides. So this is the little right angle there to make us know that it's a right triangle. This is a leg, and this is a leg. This is a kind of a funny word, so I'm not going to play hangman. What I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a picture, see if you can figure out what it is. So here's this lovely little cabin up in the Poconos. And there's seagulls. And there's the road going by. And there's mountains. And you notice something strange up in the top, though. There's a rope hanging from nowhere. And it's got like a noose, looks like some kind of a noose, and there's a pot hanging from this noose like a kettle. That's a high pot in noose. That was a really good deep sigh, by the way. I can keep going because of that. Same thing, though. I used to teach this in high school in the 80s, and I've had kids tell me, you still do that hypotenuse thing? And of course, I would draw a yellow school bus with a ROM on the side. That was the ROM bus and stuff like that. Okay. But this side right here is called the hypotenuse. And it's the relationship between the legs and the hypotenuse are what's essential. So what we're going to do is, we're going to make two squares. Here's a square. Here's a square. Here's a square. One of these guys doesn't have a magnet, so I got to put him in the middle and squish him in. Okay. All right. So because it makes a square, this is 3 times 3, so this is 3 squared. This is 4 times 4, 4 squared. This is 5 squared. Okay. Just remember, that's supposed to be a 5. Okay. Did you enjoy that, having that thing slide out of there? I have kids tell me, they said, the best part of your videos are when you drop stuff. Anyway, okay, so here you go. You get entertained. So if you have, if I could take these and put them up on top of this, right? It would only leave 3 here, 3 here, and 3 here, which would be these if I took it apart and put it around the side. So if I had this, if they weren't magnetized, I could show you this better. But it turns out that leg squared plus leg squared equals hypotenuse squared, 9 plus 16, 3 squared is 9, 4 squared is 16, equals 5 squared, which is what? 25. But just having that visual really helps you to remember the formula. And I like the fact that the L makes the right angle. So I can remember which one is an L because the leg makes a right angle, leg, right angle, leg squared, hypotenuse squared. Okay, last one. I only have a little bit of time for this one. I have to give all the credit to Marcy Anthony and her daughter Crystal in 1990. We're living in Massachusetts. I had just had my life enhanced by using manipulative blocks, so I was teaching people how to use them, and I got a phone call one day. Come over quick. I'm going to show you how to build a clock with blocks. So what they did was they got the 10 bars and they got 6 10-bar bars to make 60 minutes. Then they replaced each of the 10 bars with 2 5-bars. And they made a circle of 5 bars. I've only got 4 with magnets and 1 without, as you know. Okay, so this is all you're going to see. But once a child can skip count by 5, you know what I mean by skip count? 5, 10, 15, 20. You can teach them how to figure out how many minutes on a clock face by skip counting. So let's say that this is the minute hand, 5, 10, 15, 20, like that. But then when they get good at that, you can add the hours. 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and you go all the way around until you have a 12 o'clock. I don't know if you know this now, but analog clocks are on. If you can write in cursive and read an analog clock, you're like a spy or something, because it's a lost skill. Okay, so then I tell them, okay, this is the minute hand. What are we going to do for the hour hand? We'll take the purple one for the hour hand. So once they can tell the minutes, then I give them this one. Let's just do this time right here. And again, I'm working with kids who want to be older than they are, right? Okay, so let's do the minutes. 5, 10, 15, 20, right? Okay, now let's do the hour hand. Is that a 2 or a 3? Here's what I tell them. That two-year-old just had their birthday. How old are they today? Two. Next week? Next summer? Next Christmas? Two. The day before their next birthday, how old are they? This is painful for kids. They're going two. But it's almost three, right? But it's still two. So it's two, 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 three. So it's 2:20. Get it? Okay, that works. All right. Did you have some fun? Get some math tips? Even though I'm about to be attacked by the room monitor, I'm going to tell you one more thing. Okay, you ready? This might be worth the whole conference right now. Have you ever been teaching your kids and they're not having fun and they start crying? Who's ever had that happen? All right. I had it happen, teaching my third son. I mean, I'm supposed to be able to teach the whole world math. I can't teach my own kid. I took it personally. Anyway, I have issues. And so then he would cry, then I would cry, then we'd have timeouts, and I'd get back, and it was awful. Finally went to a friend, got humble, and I said, can you give me a learning strategy? How can I help my son learn when he, whatever I teach on Friday, I got to teach again on Monday. He forgets stuff. He gets emotional, all this. He gave me a strategy, and here it is. So what's your name? Justin. Justin Time. Okay, so you're Justin, and let's say that I'm teaching you, and you start... I don't know if you know what happened, but you have two hemispheres, and Justin just moved from the math hemisphere, which is logical, to the emotional hemisphere, which is non-mathematical, and he cannot learn anything, no matter how slow I talk or how loud I talk. Justin, right now, cannot learn math no matter who's teaching him. So how do I get him back in the math part of your brain? It might be taking a break, going to get something to eat, walking around the house, come back together. But he's still kind of stressed because he didn't understand what we were doing in the first place, which is why he's stressed now. He doesn't want to come back to that environment, so he's probably still partially over in this side, even though the tears have stopped. So here's what I'm going to tell him. Justin, I got the rest of your homework for you. You don't have to do anything. Just watch me. It's okay? Okay. So I'm going to pick, let's say we're doing double-digit multiplication. So I'll build it, write it, say it, build it, write it, say it. I'll do about four or five problems, and he just watches me. Are you stressed? And he's in the proper side of his brain, so he's learning now. You know what else is happening? He's seeing it done properly five times. When he was in this hemisphere, he was taking guesses. He was missing some. Sometimes they're right. Sometimes they're wrong. He's sending all this really bad information to his brain. His brain doesn't know what's accurate. But when I'm doing it perfectly, input is perfect. I say, okay, see you tomorrow. Justin thinks, this is cool. He comes back the next day. I said, I'm going to start off, do a couple more for you. Is that all right? Sure. Do a couple more. Hopefully at that point you'll say, can I try one? If not, I'm still the parent. I say, look, can you try one? But you know what? That works. It's called modeling. Just model it, model it, model it. But the theory is you're getting out of the subdominant emotional hemisphere. You're getting into your dominant math, cool, calm, and collected hemisphere where you can learn math. Okay, let's pray. Thank you, Father, for helping us to be creative. Give us strategies that we don't even know that we know. Help us to make math fun so that we can have fun teaching our kids and they can remember it better. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.